This presentation explains statistics related to microbial sampling plans. My name is Marcel Swietering and I'm professor of food microbiology at Wageningen University. I'm a member of the ICMSF since 2005. Stochastic processes are known from the casino, where gamblers decide where to place their bet. Believe it or not, statistics are also involved in testing food products. In order to have a good foundation for food safety, you definitely need more than only sampling. You see here a building that lasted for ages because of the solid foundation. And also for food safety systems, they should be really based on several levels of foundation. You first need your prerequisite programs, like GMP and good hygiene. Then you need a good hazard plan. You need to validate your CCPs, and then you are going to monitor your critical limits. And if you have done that all, finally, you're going to verify the adequacy of your sampling plan of your program by using microbiological criteria. If your system is only based on the last part, we're going back to the foundation of a house of cards. Only testing by microbiological criteria is not a good basis for your food safety system. Sometimes a microbiological criterion is described as absence of salmonella. Is that a well-defined sampling plan? No. On this slide, you see a sampling plan for powdered infant formula for Cronobacter and Salmonella. And in this sampling plan, you have to take 30 samples of sample weight 10 gram for Cronobacter and 60 samples of sample weight 25 grams for Salmonella. And C equals zero, meaning that no sample is allowed to give a positive result. It is important that all these three aspects are described: the number of samples N, the C value, and the sample weight. The standard method to perform the analysis must be prescribed because different methods may also yield different results. In the Codex hygiene code for PIF hygiene criteria are also described for mesophiles and Enterobacteriaceae. And here you see two important differences from the safety criteria. First of all, you see now that the C value are both equal to 2, so 2 of the samples are allowed to be positive. For Enterobacteriaceae, the test remains a qualitative test, a presence-absent test in 10 gram. But for mesophiles, a quantitative test is used, so the microbiological limit is a concentration. In this case, it's a three-class sampling plan with a lower limit small m and a higher limit big M. None of the 5 samples are allowed to be above the 5,000 per gram. 2 samples are allowed to be between 500 and 5,000, and the others have to be below 500. Testing a certain number of samples with a low level of contamination can be compared to a lottery. And here you can see 2 results of the one time with 5 negatives and one time 5 samples with 1 positive. This gives, of course, the illusion that the first batch is free of the pathogen and the second is contaminated. However, since sampling is a stochastic process, it could also be another situation. It could be that in both cases there is a very low and equal level contamination, and in the second case you got lucky and hit a positive sample, while in the first batch you didn't. And as a joke, you could even say that in the case of the positive found, the batch is now safer since at least you took out one of the pathogens from the below batch. So a positive means something, but a negative is definitely not a guarantee. It is a misconception to think that if all your samples are negative, that this is a proof that your batch is free of the pathogen. It only proves that the samples you tested are free of the pathogen. All these aspects are described in a paper in Annual Reviews in Food Science and Technology, where we looked at all kinds of distributions of microorganisms and looked at the homogeneous and heterogeneously distributed organisms and looked at presence-absent testing and quantitative testing. But I will start with the homogeneous contamination. But later we will also look at a heterogeneous high-level contamination and a heterogeneous low-level contamination. And in this paper, we also look at localized high-level contamination, localized low-level contamination. But for now, we will only describe A, B and C. And in this clip, only A, the homogeneous contamination. So if we have a homogeneous contamination, which results from an ideally mixed product like a liquid, the organism will be randomly spread, and we can look at what the performance of the sampling plan will be. On the left side, you see the prevalence of the organism in a sample, so the probability to have a defective sample. And in the next column, you see the probability to accept the batch if you would take only one sample. the probability that no contamination is found logically equals 1 minus P defective. So if a sample has a 5% probability to contain the organism, I have 95% probability to not find the organism in one sample. So to improve the performance, we often take more samples to be more sure. For example, if we take 2 samples, then we have to put this 1 minus P def to the power 2, since the first sample needs to be negative and also the second sample needs to be negative to have no positive samples in total. And for 5 samples, we have to do that to the power 5. And for 30 samples, we have to do that to the power 30. So the more samples you take, the more likely you are to detect the higher defective rates. However, even at 30 samples, the probability to detect a 1% defective rate remains rather unsatisfactory. You have still 26% probability to miss that contamination level, and if this is a serious pathogen, of course you do not want to send that batch with hundreds of thousand products to the market with a 1% defective rate. Often a 1% defective rate is not acceptable, and even a sampling plan with 30 samples has a rather high probability to miss this. So to conclude, if all samples in a sampling plan are negative, this is not a guarantee of absence in the whole batch. On the other hand, if a positive sample, that does indicate presence in the lot. Thus, while sampling and testing does not provide definite proof of absence in the whole batch, it is useful for finding big deviations and highly contaminated lots. And it's also useful to verify overall control of food safety. Further information and tools can be found on the ICMSF website.